Today is we have another webinar in the series of webinars organized by INAE. But before we go to webinar, we must remember Professor Rodham Narsimha, who was one of the founder fellows of Indian National Academy of Engineering, and who passed away 2 days back. And just to give a brief introduction, Rodham Narsimha, who was known as RN by the students, and I am saying this in the capacity of a student, because he was probably he was the chairman of my general comprehensive way back in 1976. And subsequently, also I interacted with him. He joined IISc Bangalore in 1953 to get a diploma in aeronautical engineering and followed it up with an associate degree. He went to Caltech in 1957 and completed PhD in 1961 in gas dynamics. Came back to IISc Bangalore in 1962. Joined aeronautical department, and apart from working in aeronautical department, he created or he was instrumental in setting up an interdisciplinary group in mid-70s, and ultimately it became Center for Atmospheric Sciences in 1982. And with Professor Narsimha as its convener, he was director of National Aeronautics Laboratory during 1984 to 1993, and his tenure for many initiatives, including launch of light combat aircraft. Then he was director of NEAS during 1997 to 2004, and then back to academics. He joined DMCASR, and he was there until recently. So, in respect of his memory, we'll have a silence for 1 minute. One can keep sitting, and then we'll start the proceeding. So, silence for 1 minute, please. Thank you. So we start today's webinar. Today's webinar, we'll have a brief presentation about high energy, high intensity accelerators by Dr. Mohanty, who will introduce the topic, and subsequently, Dr. Srinivas Krishna Gopal will provide the detail about high-intensity superconducting proton accelerators. First, let me introduce both the speakers one by one. Dr. Mohanty has a PhD in physics from Bombay University and has been working at the Rector Park since March 2019. In between, he was prior to becoming director, he was deputed to SINP, Science Institute of Nuclear Physics, as director. He has 36 years long association with BRC, working in several areas of nuclear physics, and he's also has been associated with Homi Bhabha National Institute, Board of Research on Nuclear Sciences, Indian Physics Association, and has received several awards, including BAE Science and Technology Award in 2001. He was also conferred the scientific associate position at CERN Geneva twice, 2002 to 2004, and then again during 2010-2011. Over to you, Dr. Mohanty, for a brief introduction of the topic, and then we'll come to Krishna Gopal.
Good evening, Dr. Grover, Dr. Krishna Gopal, and honorable members of Indian National Academy of Engineering. Krishna Gopal will be talking about high intensity superconducting proton accelerator challenges and achievement. But I just take this opportunity to spend a couple of minutes telling why such a machine we are building it. In fact, it is an international collaborative project where we are building a 800 MeV proton machine at Fermi National Laboratory, Chicago, and having partnership with countries like USA, India, Italy, France, and Poland, involving 13 national laboratories. And it is two aspects. Of course, the first aspect is to make fundamental discoveries in modern science, particularly in neutrino physics. Again, I say it is not neutron, it is a neutrino physics. Actually, a beta decay neutron decays into a neutrino, which is invisible, massless, supposed to be massless, and does not interact. So this physics, this accelerator will be proving it. And in addition, in the Indian context, we want to build a multi-purpose GeV proton accelerator in the department for technological and societal applications. For the purpose is to make an accelerator-driven subcritical reactor system for energy production. Utilizing this machine, we want to create spallation neutrons for thorium breeding. Even we want to make a GeV proton therapy machine for deep-rooted cancer treatment. Also producing radioactive ion beams for physics research, to name a few. See, when I talk about the discovery, this has a potential to do discoveries. Let me see what discovery you are thinking of. Last year, 2019, if you recall, we celebrated 150 years of Mendeleev's periodic table. This is the periodic table, and by now we have understood all elements, its properties, that element has a nucleus surrounded by the electrons. All those things is known to now. So this is a helium atom, this is a neon atom, and at the center there is a nucleus and electrons surrounded by it. Not only that, we have also understood by now that this nucleus, inside the nucleus, there are protons and there are neutrons and electron outside. And except electron, proton and neutron is not fundamental. They have structures, what we call now quarks. Like for example, proton has three quarks. They are called two up quarks, one down quarks. And similarly, neutron has two down quarks, one up quarks, and electron is fundamental. And there are other things like gluons and photons. These are the particles which bind them together. This is all known. So in other words, if I further break the periodic table in terms of fundamental particles, what we call the standard model of physicist, we'll have two categories of particles. One we call quarks, and another category we will call leptons, where electron lies. There are six quarks. They are called UD, up, down, charm, strange, top, and bottom. And below, there are electrons, muon, and tau. And associated with, there are neutrinos, electron neutron, muon neutrino, and tau neutron. And one more important particle is there, which is called H, that is the Higgs boson. You might have heard that a couple of years back it was discovered. And this is a very fundamental particle. It was proposed in 1964 by Peter Higgs, but it took almost 50 years to discover. Very difficult. It was discovered at CERN, Geneva. And this particle is created from a field which is supposed to be giving mass to all the particles. That's why it is important. This Higgs particle gives mass to all the fundamental particles, and this remained undetected for many years. And but finally it was detected, and people are very happy that this is called standard model. People thought everything on particle physics we have understood now. And in this model, the neutrino where it sits supposed to be massless. Then what happens finally, in 2013, the Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded jointly to two people, Francois Englert and Peter W. Higgs, for their theoretical discovery of a mechanism that contributes to our understanding of the origin of mass of the subatomic particles, and which recently was confirmed through the discovery of the predicted fundamental particle by the ATLAS and CMS experiment and CERN Large Hadron Collider. In fact, BRC is a party to this CMS experiment, which discovered that particle. And fortunately, I was the spokesperson of this India CMS collaboration during that time. But then what happened subsequently? Later on, in 2000 later, another Nobel Prize was given slightly differently. Like Nobel Prize in Physics 2015 was awarded jointly to Takai Kajita and Arthur MacDonald for the discovery of neutrino oscillations. What basically it means? It shows that neutrinos are not massless, it has mass. So the previous table, which I showed, it took almost 50 years to prove that we have understood everything. This discovery shows that we have not understood, because neutrino has mass. It has a tiny mass, but very important, because this is the Professor Kajita. Last year he visited BRC and gave a colloquium here. This is the photograph, he is the Nobel laureate for the second discovery. So what is the problem now? Left hand side shows that we have understood everything. Neutrinos are massless matter particles. There are three types of neutrinos. They do not interact. They interact very rarely. But now what we are finding, we have to go beyond this model, beyond standard model, that neutrinos have mass. That means this demands whatever we have understood so far for last 50 years, spending so much money making the accelerator. We need to re-examine our models, which assumes neutrinos are massless. And there are also told that there are number of there could be more neutrinos, and there could be more than three, and some of them could be part of dark matter. What basically I want to show that our understanding today of the whole universe is complete only 5%. Whatever we are seeing, only 5% we know. Remaining nearly 90% are existing in the form of dark matter and dark energy. Today, we do not understand what is dark energy, what is dark matter, matter and antimatter asymmetry. Like, we are full of matters, but there are antimatters. For example, if electron is a matter, positron is antimatter, but we find plenty of electron, but we don't find positron unless we create it. So that means we are a matter dominated, but why there is no antimatter? When the universe is created, both matter and antimatter was equal. Then what happened afterwards? So is there any extra dimension? So far we know we have a three dimension, x, y, z. If you put time, like Einstein added time, there we have four dimension. But string theorists believe that there could be as high as 10 dimensions. So those things will be more important when you go to very high and high energy. Similarly, supersymmetries and neutrinos, mass and oscillation, all those things we do not understand fully. That's why this particular machine is a step forward. Now, what you are seeing, that lengthwise, it is the machine which will be talked about in the subsequent talk. It will be producing a proton of 800 MeV energy and high current. Later on, it will be fed to a booster, which is existing tunnel, and it will make them 8 GeV, giga electron volt. Later on, it will go to 120 GeV, 120 giga electron volt. And this proton will be hitting on a target. And this target, lot of elementary particles will be produced, and they will be decay to neutrinos. And neutrinos can travel anywhere because they don't interact. So the idea is, the right-hand side is the Fermi lab. That will be producing that proton, and it will be hitting the blue one, whatever being shown, green and blue one. That the proton will be coming and hitting a target, and it will create huge amount of neutrinos. And there will be a detector, that is a short baseline detector. And since neutrinos do not interact, they can penetrate across the earth crust and will reach to the other side, that is the South Dakota, where another detector will be there under the mines. So that is called long baseline detector. And if neutrino is oscillating because of the mass, then it will be showing some property measuring at the short distance as well as a large distance. And that is the purpose of this experiment. Okay, this is as far as the physics is concerned. But what we are interested in, addition to the physics, we want to make such an accelerator in India, in participating out of the collaboration. Our aim is, we want to accelerate a proton up to 1 GeV, which will come out in the process. And we want to finally build an accelerator-driven subcritical system. That is our long aim, in addition to studying the physics. And so I should not proceed further. Dr. Krishna Gopal will be telling about this machine, how we are making, what are the engineering challenges, and what program we have in India, in addition to making the accelerator at Fermilab, how we want to proceed for subsequent year in the context of the Indian programs. That's what Krishna Gopal will be telling. And with this, I think I'll stop it here. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mohanty, for introducing the topic. Let me give a brief introduction of Dr. Srinivas Krishna Gopal. He completed his PhD in accelerator physics from Cornell University in 1990. During 1990-92, he worked at the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory on free electron laser theory. This included a study of resonator stability and new concepts such as the multi-level, multi-cavity FEL. He joined Center for Advanced Technology, now renamed Radharamanna Center for Advanced Technology in 1993. Initially worked on accelerator theory, moving to technology development, he built a group. But I will not go into the details so that we can get more time to hear what Dr. Vishnu Gopal has to say. All I'll say is that a subject matter which he's going to speak on, that is high intensity superconducting proton accelerator, in short HISPA, has many technological challenges. And let us hear from him about all the technological and scientific challenges. Over to you, Dr. Krishna Gopal.
Thank you, Dr. Grover. Dr. Grover, Dr. Mohanty, Dr. Roy, Dr. Suresh, and members of the Indian National Academy of Engineering. Thank you first for giving me this opportunity to speak on this subject. My thanks for that to Dr. Grover and Dr. Roy. And my thanks to Dr. Mohanty for giving a very nice physics motivation for this topic of high intensity accelerators. So I will be basically talking about what the challenges are in building these accelerators and what our plans are and what our status is in terms of how much we've achieved so far. So I'll start with a very brief introduction to the topic of accelerators as background. And then talk about elements of HISPA technology and their challenges. And then talk about the first step we took in this direction, that is by building the low energy, high intensity proton accelerator here at BRC, which we call LEHIPA. And then about the second step we took by entering into the Indian institutions and Fermilab collaboration to further the activities towards high intensity accelerators. And end with some comments on potential next steps for an indigenous HISPA program. So what is an accelerator? An accelerator is a device that increases the velocity or energy of a beam of particles. In our context, we are talking about charged atomic or subatomic particles, not, for example, neutrons. So typically, we talk about electrons, protons, or heavy ions. And what is a beam? A beam is a set of particles of the same type, traveling together in the same direction and with around the same energy, which means, for example, that we discount cosmic rays, which you can't call a beam. The intensity of the beam is measured in terms of a current for the simple reason that a moving charged particle constitutes a current. And so when we talk about high intensity accelerators, we are talking about currents of the order of milliamperes or tens of milliamperes. In contrast, as an example, the proton accelerator that we have working on the BRC campus called Fotia, which is a DC accelerator, has a current of only around 100 nanoamperes. So we are talking about a huge increase in current when we talk about high intensity proton accelerators. And finally, why superconducting technology? So particles are accelerated in RF cavities. And a very simple but not imprecise analogy is to think of an RF cavity or an accelerator as a microwave oven. So in a microwave oven, you have at the back of an oven a source of microwaves, which you call a magnetron. So when you turn the oven on, the microwaves come into a cavity, into a region where you put the item that you want to heat, which is the food you want to heat. And that item absorbs the energy. Identically, in a particle accelerator, you have a microwave source. Typically, these are called klystrons. These put power into a cavity called an RF cavity. And then you introduce the particle you want to accelerate, in this case, protons, into the cavity. And then they absorb energy from the microwaves. And of course, in this case, when they absorb energy, their velocity or their energy increases. The reason we use superconducting cavities, which means we make these cavities out of niobium, for example, instead of copper, is that we, as you well know, superconducting materials dissipate almost no heat. As a consequence, they are very efficient. However, there is a price to pay, which is that we need to operate these superconducting cavities at cryogenic temperature, typically 2 degrees Kelvin. So this briefly motivates the, I hope, every word in the title HISPA. What does an accelerator consist of? Well, there are four major elements to a high-intensity superconducting proton accelerator. You need, of course, a source of protons, and that's called an ion source. So this produces the protons. In every HISPA accelerator existing today, these protons immediately enter an object called a radio frequency quadrupole, which does the triple job of bunching these protons, focusing them, and accelerating them. And I'll say more about them in a moment. You then need to transport these protons, this proton, bunched proton beam forward. And these are typically done with magnets, typically quadrupole magnets and solenoidal magnets. And finally, because we are talking about the S in HISPA, you have superconducting cavities that, as I mentioned, are very efficient for acceleration that will then take these protons and accelerate them to the energy you want, say 1 GeV. To make all this happen, there are many important subsystems, which I will only briefly mention but not discuss. Cryogenics, cryomodules, RF sources, RF couplers, RF electronics, high voltage power supplies, control systems, vacuum systems, etc. But I hope this gives you a feel of the multidisciplinary character of accelerators in general, and the fact that the complexity, the multidisciplinarity leads to a complexity which makes them technologically challenging, all the more so as we are going to see for high intensity accelerators. So what are the challenges in these specifically to high intensity accelerators? First, let's look at the operational challenges. One is that we need very high reliability. For example, as Dr. Mohanty said, we may want to use such an HISPA accelerator for an ADS, accelerator driven reactor, which produces power and is coupled to a grid, electrical grid. You therefore cannot have afford to have your accelerator working at 50 or even 80% efficient reliability. It needs to work with reliabilities of upwards of 95%. Secondly, as you must have seen in one of Dr. Mohanty's slides, the beam power, the power in the proton beam, in one proton beam, for example, coming out of PIP2 is 1.2 megawatts. So these are extremely high power beams, and they have concomitant safety features, safety issues that one has to worry about. For the same reason, we cannot tolerate beam loss. Let's imagine that I have a 10 milliampere beam, and I have a beam loss of about, let's say, 1 ppm, one part per million. We're still talking about one nanoampere beam loss. So this is a fairly large beam loss, because this beam loss, remember, is of a proton that is at around 1 GeV energy. So 1 GeV energy proton, when it is lost, and when I say lost, I mean that the proton goes and hits the surface of the vacuum envelope in which these beams have to move. That vacuum envelope is usually stainless steel. So a proton beam hitting stainless steel will cause nuclear reactions, a 1 GeV proton beam, and will produce radioactivity, and can in fact radioactivate the vacuum envelope itself and possibly even the surroundings outside that envelope. Therefore, for ease of maintenance and serviceability, for even being able to approach the accelerator for maintenance, you need to make sure that the losses are minimum. In fact, the usual mandated loss is 1 nanoampere per meter. In a 10 milliampere beam. So you can imagine you're talking about less than parts per million beam loss. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, some of these accelerators, including the PIP2 accelerator I'm going to talk about at Fermilab, operate in a CW mode. So the 1.2 megawatt number I quoted was for a single beam of, single bunch of protons coming from the accelerator. In a CW accelerator, these protons come in a continuous mode, which means it's something like continuous laser pulses for those who are familiar with lasers. Otherwise, typically most accelerators are pulsed, which means you may get a bunch of, let's say, 100 of these pulses, and then you have downtime for a long time, and you may repeat at, say, a few hertz. So CW operation is particularly critical, and it is so critical that there is not a single operating CW high-intensity proton accelerator in the world. Only two countries have come close to that, one of them being the United States at Fermilab. And they, when they reached about 50% duty cycle, punctured their lost control of the beam, punctured the vacuum envelope, and have since taken a policy decision not to exceed 2% duty cycle, at least for the foreseeable future. Though, of course, in the longer term, they will move to CW. The other country that tried to do this were the Chinese, for the Chinese ADS project. 5 years ago, they actually assembled a 10 MeV accelerator with a RFQ and a superconducting module. And when they reached around 90% duty cycle, they lost control of the beam. It actually melted part of the RFQ. The copper in the RFQ evaporated, went down to the superconducting part of the accelerator, coated the niobium over there, and essentially both the RFQ and the superconducting cavity had to be junked. It took them 3 years to replace them, and about a couple of years back, when they repeated this experiment, when again they got to around 90% duty cycle, they found that they had radioactivated their surroundings, which means their beam loss was more than acceptable. This is China, so I don't know what the latest news is, but these anecdotes serve to remind us of the great caution we need to undertake when we talk about taking a HISPA accelerator and pushing it towards CW. What are the technological challenges in HISPA? I'm not going to go into the details of what challenges are there for each subsystem because that would take a lot of time. But let me briefly tell you what the what a wide spectrum of technologies are there in a HISPA, and that will give you a feeling for the complexity and the challenges there are. So first of all, one has to design and develop high current ion sources and this radio frequency quadrupole, which is perhaps the most difficult component in any proton accelerator, and which I'll talk about in a moment. One has to develop superconducting cavities, and typically they are of two kinds. At lower energies, up to 200 MeV, one builds a particular geometry called a spoke resonator. Beyond 200 MeV, one uses a different geometry, and these are called elliptic cavities. One must develop cryomodules within which these cavities sit, typically 5 to 10 cavities per cryomodule. One must have cryogenic systems that cool these cryomodules to 2 degrees Kelvin so that they become superconducting. One must have RF sources so that you can produce, you can provide energy for the cavities, into the cavities for accelerating the beam. One has these very sensitive components called RF couplers, which basically take the RF power and feed them through a very small aperture into the cavity itself. And because the aperture is small, the power density in the RF couplers is very high. So they are normally considered a very critical component of HISPA accelerators. One needs RF electronics to control the RF of the accelerator to keep it safe. One needs magnets that can focus the beam both within the cryomodule, in which case the magnet must be superconducting, and outside the cryomodule, in which case it can be normal conducting. And of course, one must have beam diagnostics instruments to know what the beam is doing, to characterize the beam. Again, superconducting if you're doing this within the cryomodule, and normal conducting if you're doing this outside the cryomodule. So you can see that there is a wide spectrum of technologies that need to be developed of various sorts. Some are mechanical in nature, some are cryogenic in nature, some are electrical, and some are electronics in nature. And this serves, I think, to illustrate the multidisciplinary area nature of accelerators in general, and of high-intensity accelerators in particular. And it's easy to see what kind of challenges can arise, not only from the development of each of these systems, but also in making all these systems work together in concert efficiently. You have seen this roadmap that Dr. Mohanty showed. So it has three major elements to it. It has a normal conducting section, typically out up to 3 MeV, comprising the ion source and the RFQ. We have conceptualized and implemented this as the low energy, high intensity proton accelerator at BRC. So the next part of my talk will focus on LIHPA. After that, the next two major modules are, as I described earlier, two types of superconducting cavities. And in order to hasten the process of developing and mastering this technology, DAE has entered into the IIFC, Indian Institutions and Fermi Lab collaboration. And the third part of my talk will focus on that collaboration. So let me first talk about LIHPA, the low energy, high intensity proton accelerator. So LIHPA is a 20 MeV, 10 milliampere proton accelerator. That is basically a technology demonstrator of the front end of a high intensity accelerator for applications such as ADS. LIHPA involves the development of several difficult technologies, such as high current ion sources, radio frequency quadrupoles, drift tube LINACs, regulated high power supplies, high power RF systems, and so on. I won't go into the details of each of them, but let me only talk about what we've done here at BRC. So LIHPA is located in the basement underground of one of the buildings at BRC in a tunnel that is basically 60 meters long and 12 meters wide. It is sectioned into two parts. So in one part, you have the ECR ion source. In our case, it's what's called it's a 50 keV ion source that can produce up to 10 milliamperes of current. The protons coming from this ion source go through what is called the LEBT, the low energy beam transport line, which transports the beam and matches it to the next section, which is the radio frequency quadrupole RFQ. The power to the RFQ comes from one of the klystrons that are on the other side of the wall. The beam from the RFQ is then transported by the medium energy transport line, or the MEBT, which then matches it with the next two accelerating sections called the drift tube LINACs, which are also powered by klystrons 2 and 3. What we have achieved so far is to accelerate beam through the RFQ and have integrated the MEBT with the beam line. And I will tell you where we are as far as the details are concerned in a minute. So here are some photographs of the system. So over here is the ion source that we have developed, which produces the 50 keV proton beam. As I said, that protons from the ion source will then go through the low energy beam transport line, which is shown over here. This consists, as you can see here, although very small, of a couple of magnets, solenoidal magnets, that will focus the beam and prepare the beam properties to be matched to the radio frequency quadrupole, the RFQ. This is a photograph of the RFQ itself. So the beam comes in from the far end and goes through this long structure, which is the RFQ. The blue component is an analyzing magnet, which we used to measure the energy of the beam in the RFQ. And the RFQ has power fed to it through these two feed points. So you have two RF couplers over here that feed power into the RFQ. The photograph here shows the klystron from which this power comes. This is a bought out item. This is a Thales klystron from France, operating at a frequency of 352 megahertz and producing 1 megawatt of power. And this is in fact a CW klystron. And the klystron itself is powered by electrical power supply, in this case a pulse modulator, which was given to us by RR Kattindor, which produces 100 kilovolts, 20 amperes pulses of 400 microseconds at a rep rate of 2 hertz. So this is basically what LEHPA is about. But let me spend one slide on the radio frequency quadrupole. So the radio frequency quadrupole, as I said, is a particularly sensitive and intricate component of any proton accelerator. In our case, this is 4 meters long, built in 4 sections of 1 meter each. And what you see in the photograph on the left is 2 of those sections. The photograph on the right shows you the cross section of the RFQ. So it basically consists of 4 vanes. These incoming objects are called vanes. And the gap between the vanes is only around 6 millimeters. And the proton beam has to travel in the gap between these 4 vanes over a length of 4 meters. To make sure that that gap is maintained constant, these vanes, which are made of oxygen-free high conductivity OFHC copper, have to be machined to tolerances of, we have successfully machined them to tolerances of 50, better than 50 microns over a length of 1 meter. The 4 vanes are machined independently and then they have to be joined together. And the metal joining technique of choice is vacuum furnace brazing. So the 4 vanes are brazed together. And after that, as you see in the picture on the left, there are a large number of ports that have to be also brazed onto this entire assembly. So there are about 120 brazed joints on this RFQ. So there are 2 different brace cycles that have to be used. And so the whole thing is pretty complex. And finally, all 4 segments of the RFQ have been assembled to within tolerances of about a little over 100 microns. I mean, tolerances that we have achieved. So that gives you, I think, a feel for the complexities in the mechanical fabrication of an RFQ. In our case, we have used a total RF power of 620 kilowatts going into the RFQ in order to accelerate beam to 3 MeV. And here are the results of the beam acceleration. So the upper curve you see that is labeled FC2 is the current trace on a Faraday cup, which is a current measuring instrument that is located after the RFQ. And we introduced an RF pulse of only 50 microseconds. And you can see, therefore, that the blue, the green trace over here gives you a short pulse of 50 microseconds, indicative of some proton current reaching after the RFQ. The two lower traces are the current pulses in the low energy beam transport line, that is just after the ion source but before the RFQ. And there we kept it deliberately longer, 1 millisecond. We then wanted to measure the energy of the RFQ, of the beam from the RFQ. So we used the analyzing magnet I showed earlier and swept the magnetic field in the magnet and plotted the current in a current monitor after the analyzing magnet. And you can see a peak at 3 MeV. We had, of course, calibrated the magnetic field versus energy. And just for comparison, we actually did detailed simulations of the energy expected as a function of power you put into the RFQ. And in fact, our agreement with simulations is excellent. We actually validated the energy of the beam by two other techniques. One was a time of flight technique, and one was a nuclear physics Rutherford backscattering technique. And all three gave exactly the same energy, 3.3 MeV. And finally, this is a fast Faraday cup we have built here and used for measuring the beam spectrum. So this is the longitudinal spectrum of the beam. Each spike over here corresponds to one proton beam. And as you can see, there is a sequence of spikes. And if I take one of these spikes and blow it up, then you get the figure on the right. Excuse me. And if you fit a Gaussian to this figure, we find that the pulse width of the proton beam is 150 picoseconds, which is exactly what we expect theoretically. So this exercise was completed in April of 2019. And I want to emphasize over here, going back for a moment to this slide, that pretty much everything that you see over here, every item that has been used in LIHPA has been developed indigenously, with the exception, as I mentioned, of the Klystron itself, because Klystrons are not made in India, and maybe some vacuum pumps. Everything that, especially the ion source, the LEBT, the RFQ, the pulse modulator, the RF distribution system, etc., everything has been both designed and developed in India, mainly at BRC. Except for the pulse modulator, which, as I said, came from our archive. So this was a significant event, and we had many dignitaries grace the LIHPA facility. We were happy to have with us our chairman, K.N. Vyasji, our director, Dr. Mohanty, our former chairman, who sadly no longer with us, Dr. Shekhar Basu, and our former chairman, Dr. R.K. Sinha. This was around April, May 2019. So the present status is that having done up to 3 MeV, we were sort of stymied by the pandemic. But we now have the hardware, that is the DriftTube Linux, that will accelerate to 10 and then 20 MeV ready with us. And they are undergoing RF tests prior to integration into the beamline. Also, the regulated high voltage power supply needed for the Klystrons, the two Klystrons for the DTLs, which were designed by the Institute for Plasma Research at Ahmedabad and developed by ECIL Hyderabad, have been installed and in fact are presently being commissioned. So we expect that we should have beam acceleration by February next year. Let me, however, try to summarize for you the achievements in LIHPA from the point of view specifically of HISPA technology and where we are. So the LIHPA ion source and RFQ have been commissioned to accelerate 2 milliampere beam to 3 MeV. And the experimental results are in good agreement with the design simulations. And we have operated this accelerator for over 800 hours, at one point for almost 3.5 weeks, continuously running 24/7. And it worked absolutely fine. So we are confident that the front end of a high intensity accelerator, that is the ion source and the RFQ, are fully demonstrated. And as I mentioned in the beginning, the low energy part of a proton accelerator is most critical. So being confident that we have mastered the front end is a significant step forward. We have developed a lot of beam diagnostics. I talked about the fast Faraday cup I show on the second figure over here, a beam position monitor we developed for measuring the position of the beam. These and other diagnostic equipments have been designed and built at BRC and installed and operated at LIHPA. On the right-hand side, you see a low-level RF system. And next to that, RF protection interlock system, which are both needed for manipulating the RF signals in the accelerator and keeping them safe. These have also been designed and developed in DRC and installed and operated in LIHPA. And in fact, very similar upgraded systems have been developed for Fermilab. And they are in fact installed at RRCAT for testing. So we are confident that beam diagnostics and RF electronics have been successfully designed and developed in India for ISPA accelerators. So this is so much about the LIHPA, which talks about the front end, the normal conducting front end. The next step, as you know, is to go from beyond 3 MeV in superconducting accelerators. And this is where the Fermilab collaboration comes in. So India is, of course, interested in ISPA for a variety of reasons. But participation in PIP2, we envisaged, would enable us to get proven ISPA technology, train our scientists and engineers, and develop essentially all individual components of the ISPA system. And therefore, we had a substantial interest in involving ourselves in virtually every subsystem of PIP2, except, of course, for the ion source and the RFQ, because these we have already taken care of. The IFC collaboration has a prehistory, going back all the way to the October 2005 agreement on science and technology signed between the government of India and the government of the United States. Subsequently, in 2011, an implementing agreement was signed between the Department of Atomic Energy and the US Department of Energy for cooperation in the area of accelerator and particle detector research and development for discovery science. This was followed by the signing of an annex to this implementing agreement focused on high-intensity proton accelerators. And finally, in 2015, we put together a document that spelled out in detail the specific deliverables we would have, contributions we would have in the R&D phase of IFC. And since August 2015, over the last 5 years, we've been working on this R&D phase of IFC. And I'll talk in a moment about what we have achieved in these 5 years. But very briefly, to read important lines from the ISPA, from the Annex 1 to the implementing agreement, it says in the text in white, the ISPA design, technology, and supporting infrastructure knowledge transfers from DOE to DAE are the planned in-kind contributions from the United States, and the engineering resources, design, manufacturing, and supply of ISPA accelerator hardware from DAE to DOE, amounting to a maximum of $200 million, are the planned in-kind contributions from India. The years don't matter because there have been delays and time has passed on. So let me talk a little bit about PIP2. So this is the PIP2 accelerator. You see at the lower left over here, the ion source followed by an RFQ, identical, similar to LIHPA. And after the RFQ, you have a variety of superconducting cavities or superconducting cryomodules, actually. I draw your attention only to their names because I'll be using them again and again. But you see over here the names SSR1, SSR standing for superconducting spoke resonator, SSR2, so there are two types of spoke resonators, and similarly LB650, which is an elliptic type of cavity, and HB650. So basically, there are two types of superconducting spoke resonators and two types of elliptic cavities. The PIP2 LINAC is technically complex, state-of-the-art superconducting RF accelerator. So our involvement in PIP2 gives us access to state-of-the-art. And this is, again, their assertion that PIP2, when it is completed and operational, will be the world's highest energy and power CW proton LINAC. And this happens to be, PIP2 happens to be the first accelerator project in the United States to be built with major international collaborations. This is something the United States has not done before. And this outlines the kinds of in-kind contributions. And you will see that India has by far the largest component of contributions to virtually every aspect of PIP2. So for example, we are producing SSR1 and SSR2 cavities, as well as LB650 and HB650 cavities. We are producing SSR2 cryomodules and HB650 cryomodules. We are producing RF systems, both RF sources as well as LLRF systems for SSR1, SSR2, LB650, and HB650. And we are also involved in cryogenics through a cryo plant. So this gives you a feel for the degree to which we are embedded into the PIP2 project. Here is the latest status on PIP2. PIP2 has achieved acceleration up to 10.4 MeV. in a facility they call PIP2IT. So you can see over here the ion source, the RFQ, the transport line, and then two superconducting cryo modules. It is heartening to note that the MEBT over here has magnets that have been completely supplied from India, from DRC. The SSR1 cryo module over here has 8 cavities, all of which are powered by RF sources that have been supplied by India from DRC. And one of the cavities, one of these 8 cavities is an Indian cavity. So already in at Fermilab, in their initial achievement of 10.4 MeV, there is a substantive Indian contribution. This details completely the items that India is involved in the R&D phase of PIP2. I will not go through them other than to note that they cover every point I marked out earlier as being essential challenge, technological challenges for HISPA. The items in green are things that we've already completed. So just as a couple of examples, SSR1 cavity fabrication and dressing are done. SSR2 cavity design is done, but fabrication, etc. are remaining. Similarly, H2, HV650 cavity design, fabrication, processing, testing, everything is done. RF amplifiers are done, and so on and so forth. So you can see again the broad spectrum of activities that we are addressing almost simultaneously. And we also have proposed scope in the PIP2 construction phase. Again, I won't go through this except to point out two things, items number 2 and 4, SSR2 cryo module with cavities and components, and HV650 cryo module with cavities and components. So the intent over here is to deliver to Fermilab a single SSR2 cryo module and an HV650 cryo module with all components within the cryo module, which means the cavities, the RF couplers, the tuners, the magnets, the support systems, the diagnostic systems, the LLRF system, the RFPI system. So essentially one full SSR2 cryo module and one full HV650 cryo module in PIP2 will be Indian. And the purpose of insisting on this kind of deliverable is that any HISPA accelerator is basically a multiplication of individual cryo modules. So if you have mastered one cryo module, you know immediately that it's only a question of doing it in scale. And therefore, the moment we know that these SSR2 and HV650 cryo modules work well in PIP2, we are absolutely confident that we have completely mastered the requisite technologies. And the other things that I've listed, the amplifiers and the magnets, these are things that we have already delivered to Fermilab. So we have no concerns on those grounds. Let me briefly talk about what we have achieved without going into details of what we have done. So for example, we have done a complete physics and mechanical design of the SSR2 cavity, which has been reviewed by Fermilab. We have built, as I have said earlier, the SSR1 cavity, which was fabricated and dressed in India. And this, in fact, according to Fermilab themselves, is the best performing cavity of all 8 cavities that are in their first cryo module. Cavity number 6 in the cryo module will see beam in December 2020. So I think it is reasonable to conclude that we are confident that we can design, fabricate, and dress spoke resonator cavities in India because we've done it. Similarly, you can see over here HV650 cavities. That is, these are 5-cell elliptic cavities that have been built at RRCAT. You can see a number of them have already been built. They have been jacketed at RRCAT using a very special glove box that RRCAT developed specifically for this purpose. And in fact, most recently, the slide I'm showing has data that is slightly old. Most recently, last week, in one of these cavities, RRCAT has achieved the design accelerating field of 28 megavolts per meter. The slide shows only 15.5. So with this very latest development, all of which has been done at RRCAT, from the fabrication to the processing to the dressing and the testing, we can say that we are confident that we can design, fabricate, process, dress, and I should have added test elliptic cavities in India. And this is again a very, very important milestone. Finally, we have, as I mentioned, built 7 kilowatt RF amplifiers, and 9 of them have been given to a Fermilab. 3 of them have already been used. 6 more will be used in the coming months. A 20 kilowatt prototype, and this is at 325 megahertz. A 20 kilowatt prototype has actually been developed and tested at BRC. Meanwhile, RRCAT has been focusing on the 650 megahertz RF sources, and they have built and tested a 40 kilowatt amplifier, in fact, tested in the presence of Fermilab engineers. Similarly, we have built a superconducting SSR2 solenoid, was developed at BRC and successfully tested recently at 2K. And earlier, we have, as I had also mentioned, we have sent normal conducting quadrupoles that populate the MEBT of PIP2. So, and they have been used in the 10.4 MeV acceleration. So I think it is reasonable for us to say that solid state RF sources and magnets have been successfully designed and developed in India for HISPA applications. And finally, final slide on achievements. We have done a lot of work on cryogenics, not directly for Fermilab, but our own development here at BRC. So for example, we have a 4.5K cold box available. We are building turbo expanders, heat exchangers, cryogenic transfer systems, and so on and so forth. And so a substantial amount of activity has gone on over here. And in fact, four cryogenic engineers, three from BRC and one from RRCAT, have actually spent 1 to 2 years each at Fermilab to learn more about cryogenic systems that will be useful for HISPA accelerators. But there are other non-technical benefits from IFC, which are also useful for us. One is HISPA documentation. So one of the requirements was that DOE give us this documentation. And we have already received over 1,600 documents. And in fact, many more will come as we move forward in the collaboration. These documents include detailed 3D models, 2D fabrication drawings, and so on and so forth. We have had we have a visitor program to Fermilab. So far, 13 long-term visitors have been at Fermilab for durations of 1.5 to 2 years. And these people have worked, sitting embedded into the Fermilab teams, have worked on various areas of relevance to the HISPA technology and have learned and gained substantial experience and have returned. Almost all of them have returned. Because of COVID, the third batch that were to go in April or May last year could not leave. Around 15 short-term visitors have been to Fermilab for durations of varying from 1 to 3 months. And these visitors have focused on very specific tasks to be done, especially with equipment available not in India but at Fermilab. And they too have learned, gained substantial expertise and returned. And these people are all available to us to start our own programs. We have, in the last couple of years, especially, deepened the involvement of Fermilab visitors coming to India to help us in testing and in testing equipment and in setting up infrastructure over here. And this is an important aspect because an expert from Fermilab visiting here can interact with a larger number of Indian colleagues. And in that sense, there is a greater utility to that, that kind of visit. We have an arrangement with we have asked Fermilab or we have asked DOE actually to make an arrangement to allow the import of HISPA related items from the US to all DAE laboratories. You know, as you know, there are selectively issues for some DAE labs to receive some of these imports. Recently, Fermilab has so we gave them four items as test cases. An RF amplifier, MATLAB software, some special low temperature sensors, and some very special type of piezo motors. And over the last 1 year, Fermilab has been through the governmental process in the United States. And very recently, they have now received an export license from the US Department of Commerce for enabling us to buy these items from American vendors. And we have started the process of raising indents to exercise this arrangement. If once all the wrinkles are worked out of this arrangement, we will extend this to a much, much larger gamut of items that we would like to import. And it's very important to note that this import is not just for our commitments towards Fermilab, but for our domestic programs also. And finally, more recently, DOE has agreed that through the collaboration, we can get information on HISPA technology, not only from Fermilab, but from any DOE laboratory. This took a little bit of pushing from our side, but it happened. And in fact, our colleagues at BRC working on the LLRF systems have received a source code on LLRF from the Lawrence Berkeley Laboratory, which is also a DOE lab. So I've tried to summarize the achievements both from LEHIPA and the IFC collaboration. So the question is, what are the next steps in HISPA? Before talking about the next steps, I've tried here in a very cartoonish manner to summarize where we are as far as technologies items are concerned. So I've tried to list a bunch of areas, technology areas, and tried to indicate their status in a very simple way. Green indicates items that are under control, which typically means that we have actually built and delivered something. The yellow is under development, which means that we are actively working on it, and these are under various stages of completion. Some of them are actually quite advanced. And finally, there is only one area where we have not yet addressed anything. So let me run through this very briefly. Physics design, ion source, RFQ, we think are under control because of LEHIPA, and a certain design of a superconducting accelerator I'll talk about in a moment. Spoke cavity design and development and elliptic cavity design and development. We have already, as I said, built a spoke cavity, sent it to Fermilab. It has tested out well, and it will accelerate beam by the end of this month. So that should actually, that's a very big step forward. The only reason I leave it yellow is because we did not do the cavity processing in India. This was processed in Fermilab. So when we do that, I think that yellow will turn green. Elliptic cavities, I've pointed out, RRCAT has done everything. So they have been through the entire gamut of activities related to cavity development. Cavity processing and testing facilities have been fully set up at RRCAT, and in fact, the final test of what is called a horizontal test facility is going to take place within a couple of months. Cryomodule design is something that we are working on actively at the moment, both on the SSR cryomodule as well as the elliptic cavity cryomodule, and that will fructify, I believe, by the end of 2021. A cryomodule fabrication is the only area that we say is not addressed, mainly because the designs are not final. But I must say that some amount of fabrication has been done at RRCAT for earlier designs for different purposes. So it is not that we have not at all gotten our fingers wet in this area. Cryogenics, as I have tried to show, we are already doing many things in cryogenics. And the point I forgot to mention, the cryogenic plant is something that we have been engaging with vendors and Fermilab in design of this cryo plant, and will continue to do so in the future. RF sources have already been delivered to Fermilab, so they are under control. RF electronics and RF couplers are actually under advanced development. The only reason I do not show RF electronics to be green is that even though they have been implemented in LEHIPA, they have not yet been implemented with a superconducting cavity, and this will actually take place at the horizontal test stand in RRCAT in a couple of months, after which, if it is successful, I think that can also turn green. And finally, beam diagnostics and magnets, I think I've already argued, we have, especially beam diagnostics, we have done very extensively for the EPA, and magnets, again, we have delivered to Fermilab, and they have worked successfully. So this then is a summary of HISPA technology status. And you will see that there is now, by the way, this is something I have been maintaining for the last 3 years. And over time, I've seen this grow from mainly red and yellow to now mainly green and yellow. And looking at the state of the status, the substantive things that are under control and the other things that are under substantial development, it seems that it is not a bad idea to think about the next steps forward. So going back to the roadmap that Dr. Mohanty showed, the first step we have completed, which is basically LEHIPA, the normal conducting part of it. The next two steps are superconducting cavities. And I've tried to show you in the last 15 minutes that we have taken very large strides in mastering the technologies involved in building these cavities. And therefore, the next step is, I think, the logical next step, I think, is to start thinking very seriously about an indigenous accelerator that will be superconducting. And the importance of this also lies in the statement I made earlier, that we have a large number of people who are being trained through this collaboration. And it's important that we leverage whatever they have learned and whatever they are learning as quickly as possible before it atrophies with time. So one suggestion is that one could build possibly at a greenfield site like the BRC Vizag campus, a multipurpose 200 MeV, 10 milliampere high intensity superconducting proton LINAC, which can have multiple beam lines for applications such as ABS, RIB, radioisotope production, proton therapy, etc. And by and large, this can be built probably in three phases. In a first phase over 3 years, developing infrastructure, developing the LINAC front end, which we have already done, so we know that is only duplication, and doing cavity and cryo module prototyping, because our cavities are slightly different from the Fermilab ones. We have tuned them for 10 MeV. In phase two, going for another 3 years, one would then develop the 40 MeV worth of that LINAC. And at 40 MeV, you can also already produce very useful radioisotopes. And that is the reason for choosing that particular energy. There is also some other accelerator-related reason for cutting off at 40. And finally, in 3 more years after that, that is over a total of 9 years, that should be 200 MeV, not 100, 200 MeV LINAC with its utilization. Where are we on that? What are the deliverables? Well, I won't go through this since I think we are running out of time. But basically, this just tries to say what specific deliverables will be set up in that process, could be set up in that process. But where are we now? Actually, we have already completed a detailed physics design of a 200 MeV LINAC. And very recently, in September this year, we actually had this design published in Physical Review. We thought it was useful to publish this design because while we have, of course, we think done a good job of it, having an international peer review, we thought was a good idea. We had earlier, of course, had this reviewed by Fermilab, and they were quite happy with the design. But now we have a properly peer-reviewed design. So this design talks about a 300 MeV, a 200 MeV proton accelerator. It has three different families of single-spoke resonators, SSRA, SSRB, SSRC. And we have done very detailed designs, including reliability analysis and error studies for this LINAC. The paper itself is almost 30 pages long. And very briefly, this is a very broad schematic layout of such a LINAC, how it would look like, and what kind of auxiliary facilities would be needed in a greenfield site to make this kind of accelerator work. Well, so let me conclude. I hope I'm in time. So high-intensity superconducting proton accelerators are at the core of a number of important mega-science projects of the future. Radioactive ion beams, radioisotope production, ABS, spallation neutron source, etc. There are significant technological challenges in building these accelerators. LEIPA was a first important step in this direction, and it has demonstrated very successfully and I think convincingly the normal conducting front end. Under the IIFC collaboration, substantial progress has been made in a wide variety of areas, especially pertaining to the superconducting part of the accelerator. And the progress is benchmarked in terms of successes, not just in terms of having built something, but actually having deployed something in a working accelerator at Fermilab. And therefore, I think it is an opportune time to launch a domestic HISPA program, such as the one outlined, a 200 MeV multipurpose LINAC in a greenfield project such as ISAC. And let me conclude finally by thanking a large number of people. As I mentioned, these are large efforts and multidisciplinary efforts. I must thank my colleagues at BRC, spread over 12 divisions of BRC who worked on LEIPA, colleagues from RRCAT who have contributed to LEIPA, all my colleagues at BRC, RRCAT, VECC, and IUAC who work on IFC, and colleagues from Fermilab and other partner countries who have contributed to our growth in HISPA technology. And I apologize if I have left anyone out. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Krishna Gopal, for taking us through all the details. It was a long and difficult journey, but we can see that by commissioning LEIPA and by contributing to Fermilab through the collaboration, India has really done well. And I also note that the challenges to HISPA technology, they span, I think, almost all disciplines, mechanical, electrical, electronics, cryogenics, and so on. and design, the statements which you made with regard to designing, replicating, and testing cavities, that really indicated the kind of confidence which you and your colleagues have now in this particular technology. So I requested all the people attending the lecture to post their question in the chat box. But before the other questions come, let me start with a question from my side. When you spoke about Lehipa, you talked about Klystron as the only component which had to be brought from outside. I think you indicated it was purchased from France. Can you tell us the kind of program which we have now in India to develop that also indigenously so that we are not dependent on import even with regard to Klystron?
Yes. So there are two ways of looking at this Klystron issue. One is, of course, to start an indigenous program for developing Klystrons. And to some extent, this has been initiated with Siri Pilani. In fact, has been going on for a while at Siri Pilani. However, there is another aspect to it, which is that when you talk about superconducting proton accelerators, these superconducting cavities are typically powered, each of them individually. So an individual power source for each of them. That is why, for example, the Fermilab has 8 cavities for which they have 8 of our RF amplifiers. So except for the RFQ, which needs a large amount of power, I showed you 600 kilowatts. The other cavities, for example, the spoke resonator cavities, are each of them at Fermilab now need only 7 kilowatts of power. So the trend in the world has been to move towards solid state amplifiers. And those are the amplifiers that we have built at both BRC and RRCAT, and indeed at RRCAT for Indus 2 also. So the trend has been to move towards solid state amplifiers with one amplifier powering one cavity. And therefore, as far as a HISPA accelerator is concerned, the onus on having the Klystron technology succeed here is much less, because you have only the RFQ left to deal with. And to deal with the RFQ, instead of going for a Klystron, one could also think of going for lower power devices like IOTs or Tetrodes, because anyway the Klystron takes multiple feed points. So right now we take power from the Klystron, split it in two, and feed in two places in the RFQ. We could feed in four places. So I could then have four sources of 1/4 the power, and then power the RFQ individually with them. And those Tetrode devices can probably more easily be developed in India, because that technology is somewhat simpler.
Thank you. And there is a question from Dr. R. K. Singh. What are the challenges for scaling up from Lehipa to ADS? Lehipa to ADS, is that talking of HISPA? Apart from complexities of high energy and control, any thought has been given to the various parameters that could be significantly influencing the performance from your operating experience so far?
Main transition, of course, is the fact that Lehipa from 3 to 20 MeV will use drift tube Linacs, which are normal conducting. But we all understand that for ADS, or indeed any new modern accelerator that we build, beyond 3 MeV, it will be superconducting. And that's precisely the purpose of this Fermilab collaboration. Now, we have, of course, as I've tried to point out, built individual cavities. And if you can build one, you can build many. I have also pointed out the importance of building one full cryo module and making it work, because then the rest of the accelerator is simply a multiplication of cryo modules. So the challenge lies in, as mentioned, the challenge of scale, which is that having built, let us say, 5 cavities, how effectively can you build 50 of them? These cavities at the moment have been built within the national labs, within BRC or RRCAT, with some help from industry. But presumably to build very large numbers of them, one would have to involve Indian industry. And this, I think, is a crucial point, because it is also not the mandate of national labs to build these kinds of items in large numbers. Involving Indian industry, however, is not simple, because the technology is complicated. And to involve industry, you must make sure that there is a positive commercial angle to the entire enterprise. And one must work hard at ensuring that the QA, QC requirements of learning accelerators are met. So these three things I think are important in making sure that we are able to scale to an EDS level project. However, as I have suggested over here, if one were to think of an intermediate point at 200 NeV, not 1 GeV, then the numbers are smaller, and therefore one can have much closer interaction with industry and not have to immediately go into a productionized assembly line kind of system, which I think would be difficult for industry to enter into very quickly.
Okay, there's no other question in the, am I missing any question? Any audience has, you can please post in the chat box, and before any question comes, I have a question with regard to export control. A non-technical question which you mentioned that Fermilab has been able to get license with regard to export control. It is the typical 810 control under 810 or something else?
So what they have done is that they have asked for a special dispensation where, as I said, in this case only four items would be permitted to be exported to India. The important point is that this end user inspection clause is to be waived, or rather to be interpreted as the inspection of documents at OIC, at DAE headquarters. So with that understanding, they have, so this has gone through, the Department of Energy, the Department of Defense, Commerce, etc. And also this, what is it,
NNSA. National Nuclear Safety Administration.
NNSA, so it has gone through NNSA and got clearances from all of them. And what we are doing is raising indents to make sure how this is operationalized and make sure that it works as smoothly as we would like it to. Once that is done, then we will open up a much larger umbrella of items that should come within this export control dispensation.
Okay. Thank you. I think this is this aspect is a non-technical aspect, but very important aspect as we establish collaboration in several areas with USA. I remember at some stage when I was involved in discussion with Fermilab, these issues were cropping up again and again. I'm glad to note that the issue has been sorted out now.
I have a question.
Please go ahead.
Yeah, first of all, I congratulate Dr. Mohanty and the full team for this nice achievement. My question is that, as you very rightly said, that numbers are few, but quality is very stringent for this type of programs when you develop the industry. So what are all the motivating factors you have used for Indian industry to come up to your requirement of this international level?
So let me talk separately for the RFQ, which is part of LEIPA and the superconducting cavities. So as far as the RFQ is concerned, we actually we got basically the production done by this BrahMos in Trivandrum, so which is basically an offshoot of defense. Well, it's a joint venture between DRDO and the Russian agency. So there was some understanding, of course, of the importance of this, but it also meant our people spending very large amounts of time parked in their premises to make sure that there were no shortcuts taken and that the quality specifications we wrote down in indents and other documents were actually implemented on the ground. And there was a long and steep learning curve over there, and I think it was hard at that time, but I think we benefited a lot from it. As far as the superconducting cavities are concerned, these cavities have basically been made in the national labs. So except for the forming of these cavities, which has been done outside for the spoke resonators, the welding of the cavities and the processing of the cavities has been done in-house. So for the SSR cavities, IUAC did the welding, electron beam welding, and DRC did the jacketing of the cavity. For the HB650 cavities, RRCAT did the welding and the jacketing of the cavities, and also, as I said recently, the processing and the testing of the cavity to get this wonderful result of 28 megavolts per meter. So that is what I was saying, that right now we have done individual cavities successfully. That shows that we have the right techniques. The important thing is now to learn from our earlier experiences and go out to industry and transfer this understanding and this knowledge to the industry in a manner that that allows them to make it successfully. I should just add one very small point here. We have had a lot of discussions, especially 2 weeks back, we had a technical workshop with all the crypto partners. And one of the things that all the partners, especially the European partners from France and Italy and UK and Poland said was that even for them, they are building large amounts of cavities for the European spallation source and have already built them for the Euro XFEL. And they have vendors who specialize in these cavities. They said that even for them, they had to make sure that their people were parked at the vendor and were scrutinizing and making sure that there were no shortcuts taken. So we learn from that, that one has to be very careful and really hold hands in moving forward on this.
Thank you, Dr. Krishnagopal. I see no more questions. This is, let me thank you for taking us through this journey of coming to this level. We started with Lehipa, explained to us what benefits we have drawn from the collaboration in Fermilab and how Indian institutions have contributed to the effort being made there. And he also took us through the ambitious plan, bringing us having a facility at Vizag eventually, it might take something like 9 years to build. Thank you very much. So with this, let us close this webinar. And thank you to all the audiences who have stayed with us throughout. And namaskar.